Our hard-earned money has to work harder for it to grow at least at 10 to 12%. If I have to get him to do engineering in a good college in India, it would be, let's say, 20 to 30 lakhs. Entrance exam preparation itself would have costed me around 7 to 8 lakhs.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of Chasing Dreams with EduFund. My name is Ila Dubé, and I'm the founder. Today, we have an extraordinarily special guest with us today, Kalpen Parakh, who is the CEO of DSP Mutual Fund. A lot of us know him in his professional capacity as the CEO of the company. What a lot of us may not know is he's the doting father of a 17-year-old. Welcome, Kalpen, to today's episode of Chasing Dreams. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yes. So my first question to you is, as a father, what was the biggest surprise about raising a child?
I think it's been a very easy and enriching journey. I don't think I had any surprises. I think it's been a joy every day to be a father. So when my son was born, obviously, you know, when kids are very, very tiny and few days old, they don't look that good. So I used to tell my wife that, you know, why is he looking like this?
It's a little alien.
I was a bit nervous about holding him because, you know, he was a bit weak and there was this anxiety. But after that, after the first few days, every day has been very enriching. And like I was telling you before, that even though he's 17, he still, you know, there are most of the days he sleeps with me, he needs to hold me. Except the last few months where I now realize he's grown up. And to me, that is a surprise that he is now actually growing up. And he probably has a mind of his own and a world of his own that will start soon.
When we think of time and raising a kid, what is one important piece of advice that you would give parents?
I would only say that the biggest learning all of us have had is we can't preach or teach our children. We can only conduct ourselves in a certain manner, and our conduct is what they see and they observe, and that's how they become what they become. I became what I became to a large extent seeing what my father was. We never spoke a lot, so more than verbal communication, it's visual observations. So I think if we are a good human being at home, children see that. And I feel he's growing up to someone who we are very proud of. And, you know, very shortly he will go into the world outside, because till now he's been with us all through. He's just finishing his entrance exams for engineering.
Okay.
So we are at a moment where he'll be happy if he gets into the best of colleges anywhere in India. But that also means moving away from us.
Yes.
Good for him, but not necessarily good for us.
Have you given much thought to what kind of colleges you want him to go to? Does he have that flexibility? How involved are you in that decision?
So we took this decision after 10th. See, there are very limited streams of education generally conventional families mm-hmm. think of. So at this stage, the idea is give entrance exams for IITs, which will have a lot of other engineering colleges in Mumbai and outside Mumbai, but mostly in India only. So that's the work, that's the stream that we're trying to follow right now.
And have you done any investigation on the cost of what
so
higher education?
So ideally, it's a very important milestone in an Indian's life, because for all of us, education is, you know, what makes us
yes.
or creates our identity.
It's in our DNA.
Yeah, so if someone says, who are you? Before I say Kalpen Parakh, maybe I say I'm an engineer and an MBA, right? We are known by our degrees, right or wrong, is yes. always debatable. So education is so, so critical. But I'll tell you, in his case, I have not really needed to think about the cost of education. Broadly, I know that, if I have to get him to do engineering in a good college in India, it would be, let's say, 20 to 30 lakhs.
For
4 years, if he gets it on merit.
Okay.
If not, it would be 2x of that.
Okay.
I know that his entrance exam preparation itself would have costed me around 7 to 8 lakhs.
Wow.
And that's still on the lower side because we went with some of the unknown names and not the very known names where the competitive intensity is too high in terms of, you know, putting too much of pressure on the child. Cost of education is crazy in India, even to even get in. The entrance exam costs are high. After that, the cost of study. And of course, if you go abroad, broadly, I do know that it costs anywhere between 3 to 4 crores over a whole cycle.
Yes.
But because we're not pursuing that line at this point in time, I'm not thinking about it. But let me tell you another thing, that I randomly ended up being in the mutual fund industry right from day one.
Serendipity.
Yes.
It was serendipity.
So right from day one, I came in the investment world since the time I passed out, and that was 98. So intentionally or unintentionally, right from day one, I have been saving. I have been saving every rupee out of my earnings, or at least 90% of my earnings, into mutual funds.
Okay.
That is my only means of saving. I don't have any other asset class for saving, because this has been one of the best, most democratic, most transparent, most cost efficient, most tax efficient, most regulated asset class product available. So I became an investor without thinking of a goal. The only thought in my mind was that if I have money in hand, that money should go into investing in mutual funds. Because why should it remain idle in a bank deposit?
Right.
Why should I give it to a bank at a 7% return and the bank is deploying that money at 9%?
Yes.
Why not directly go and invest in what is giving me that 9%, so on and so forth? India is also a country with inflation. Education is a goal with superior inflation. Medical inflation is very high. Lifestyle inflation is very high. All of these are very important needs for Indians. And the costs keep going up by 10 to 20%, depending on, you know, time to time. So if our savings do not keep pace with that, it becomes a huge struggle much later in life.
So if people look to you or were to say, how do I start, you know, as a parent, let's say, forget they don't want to be an equity investor, they don't want to go into futures and options, they just want to start for their kids because they believe there's merit. What advice would you give to have them start?
Every year, the value of our savings is depleted by 5 to 6%, which is inflation.
Yes.
So if we start with 100 rupees of savings, the value of, if we do nothing with that 100 rupees, the value of that 100 actually goes down to 95 in year one and then 90 in year two. Over time, it is depleting because the dimension of cost, which is called inflation. In our life, different expenses have different rates of inflation. So buying vegetables, they will fluctuate at 5-7% rate. You know, I had this insight sometime, I think 15 or 20 years back when one of our financial planners said that just do an exercise of writing down on the left-hand side all your streams of income and writing down on the right-hand side all your monthly streams or annual streams of expenses. And it took me less than half a second or 1 second to write the income stream, because there was only one stream of income, which is my salary.
Yes.
It took me more than 2 hours to write down the stream of expenses, because there are hundreds of different types of expenses that we live through every day, whether it is our fuel expense, our electricity expense, the maids, the school fees, so on and so forth. So the expense side had more than 100 items and the income side has only one item. Now, that was like a tube light moment, that the income stream, if it is going to be only one, and the expense stream is so big, and the rate at which expenses grow is the inflation.
Of course.
And that inflation for most of us is between 9 to 10%. Salaries most likely may or may not grow at 9 to 10%. So if we do not make our money work and make it grow at a rate which is higher than the rate at which our expenses are growing, at some point in time, there will be a huge gap between how much we have in our hands as savings and how much is the need for us to, you know, live a decent life. You know, with that concept, the only advice I would give is be clear that money, our hard-earned money, has to work harder for it to grow at least at 10 to 12%. The point I'm making is the only way you can make your money grow faster than inflation is by becoming owners of businesses. And you can become owners of businesses either by, you know, owning stocks or investing in stocks, or investing in a vehicle which is doing the job of investing in stocks in a very professionalized manner. So now again, 99.9% of human beings don't have either the bandwidth or the skill set to pick and choose good companies and become owners of these companies and build a portfolio on their own. And if you can't do that, give it to professional money managers. Mm-hmm. And that is how you should start thinking about building a pool of savings.
And I think the one thing that we often come across at EduFund is this whole mentality of aage chalke dekhenge, right? Or I'll delay and wait to start investing or saving. But by the time that event comes and you need that defined amount, you don't want to be scrambling, or you're not able to, and then you have to compromise, you know, on the child's goal, which no parent wants, right?
But I think it is the lack of that awareness or, you know, visualization of the future, because for parents of newborn kids, or for, you know, parents of very young kids, the need for education, the real big education needs, come maybe 10 or 15 years later, and they think it's too far in the future. But like you said, time flies and it's never too far and it is always too late. I'll give you an example. The richest man on earth, almost the richest man on earth, who also is the richest investor on earth, who also is the finest investor on earth, from whom most of us have learned our investing principles, is Warren Buffett. And his company is worth $800 billion. His own worth would be around $200 billion. He's very wealthy, and his rate of return is around 18 or 19% per annum. But the beauty about his investing, and this is what he quotes, is he made his first investment at the age of 11, and he says that, "I repent that I started 11 years late." Now there's a lot of power in the statement, that what he's trying to say is that I lost 11 years of compounding. And just academically, if I were to do the math, if he had got 11 more years to compound at 19%, his current wealth would have been four times higher. So the $800 billion, if you double it twice, 800 becomes 1600, and 1600 becomes 3200. He would have been $3.2 trillion. So what I'm trying to say is, the most powerful component in your investing outcomes is time.
Yes.
And the reason for that is, in the formula of compounding, which is amount is equal to principal 1 plus return divided by 100 raised to the power of time, there are three variables. Principal, which is how much money you can save every year or every month. And next to principal is the multiplication sign, which is a powerful sign because it's multiplying. Then in the bracket, there is return. Most of us are obsessed on return.
Yes.
But the sign next to return is plus. It's less powerful than multiplication. And after the bracket is raised to T. And the operating variable next to time is raised to exponential function, is more powerful than the multiplication function, more powerful than the addition function. So the formula is lending the highest importance to time by giving it the sign of exponentiality. So the sooner we start, and the only way we can get more time, we don't know when we are going to die. We don't know when we are going to be born. Our parents decide that. The total time we have is from birth to death. There is a concept called cradle to grave investing.
Mm-hmm.
So if parents can start thinking that, okay, you know, if we are blessed with a child, it's a great happy occasion. Let's distribute sweets and throw a party and, you know, celebrate with friends and family. Great, joyous thing to do. But it should be the first day to even say that, let me start the first investment for my child, so that his time horizon is the longest.
So let's come back to the topic of you saving and investing for your own child, right? And the costs related to his education. So between the time that he was born and he's now 17. Right? What has the cost of that education looked like for you as a parent, if you don't mind sharing?
So I think, we were not very fussed about very reputed schools or colleges on day one. Our whole decision making was to keep it simple, which is the nearest school from where
proximity.
We lived, proximity, so that the child doesn't have to, you know, waste time and commute. And largely our experience, at least in India, has been that most schools and colleges have very similar levels of education at large if you are in the, you know, top two quartiles of colleges or schools. So proximity was the starting point. So if I remember, the annual cost would have been 75,000-80,000 per annum, and you add books and stationery and all of that, would be 1 lakh per annum.
Okay.
So 10 years of schooling would be 10 lakhs, 10 plus 2, so would be, let's say, 12 or 13 lakhs. In my days, it was hardly anything. It was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 rupees. And I studied in a convent school.
Wow.
I keep telling my son that the president of India had come to our school to give us an award of the best school.
Wow.
So even though...
Congratulations.
Yeah. I don't know how much it means in terms of education, but in our days, education was far more, cheaper.
Costs
have gone up because of a lot of extra, frills that comes with education. The school will have a tennis court and a cricket court, and whether the child plays or not, all these costs get loaded. But still, I would say that in a city like Mumbai, in a premium suburb like Vile Parla, which is, closer to Juhu, where most of the Bollywood stars live, the cost of education was not as exorbitant like in many other premium schools. And now, of course, he's just given his 12th standard exams. We are awaiting results. And once we get to know... So I remember when I did my engineering between 91 to 95, and then another 2 years of MBA, the whole fee, if I remember what my father would have paid, would have been around 4 or 5 lakh rupees then, which was very precious for him. It was not easy to get that 5-6 lakh rupees. I think now the cost for him annually would be easily 8 to 10 lakh rupees per annum, only for engineering. And if I would have thought of sending him abroad, it could have been 4 to 5 times higher. So costs, I don't think the inflation in college fees is only 10%, it's much higher. And so thankfully, because like I said, I have been an investor right from day one of my career, I didn't have to worry about doing the maths. But for 99.99% people, the maths is not an easy math. And hence, you have to start early. You have to fail much early. So coming to your question, the cost would be around, let's say, 7-8 lakhs annually. And the first milestone for us is 4 years of engineering. And then we'll see what's next after that. I think in these days, trends and fashions and fads in terms of what to study also is going through changes every few years faster.
Yes.
So we haven't really thought deeply about what degree he should get, so we've been very clear that whatever you do well. Focus on, so even if you want to study music, you want to study arts, you want to study history, you want to do law, science, commerce, you choose, no pressure, but whatever you do it with full commitment, and get excellence in that. And once you do what you do with some degree of excellence, eventually you'll find your way. Though, like I said, he has chosen engineering as a stream, which is obviously more expensive than many other streams of education because less number of good colleges, very high demand for students to come into that stream. So obviously costs are higher.
So let's say I'm a parent and I know that I may be paying 2 lakhs a year for my child's education fees, which is an amount I didn't even think.
Imagine.
Or imagine, right? But I don't know where to start, or I'm afraid of starting. How do they start? What is your advice to them?
So having a financial plan is very important. And to have a financial plan, you need someone who understands how to coach you or advise you with regards to your financial plan. You mentioned you have more than 1 lakh people who are subscribed to your app and on your channel. Now, all 1 lakh individuals may have 1 lakh unique financial plans.
Absolutely.
So like I said, the starting point has to be search for a good platform which can guide you, which can tell you how this journey is and who can be with you all through in this journey.
Yes, it's definitely not a one-size-fits-all model. And, talking about time, everyone has a different time horizon.
Time horizon.
We have parents that come to us, and I'm sure you have clients that come to you that have maybe 15 years on hand.
True.
You were lucky to start right away.
Yeah.
Before your child was born. Some people will come to you and say, look, I have 3 years, what do I do?
Yeah,
you
true,
know?
Exactly.
So I think you're 100% spot on that it's very individualized, right? And that makes it even more important to start thinking about it early, because you cannot take someone else's advice on what they're doing and apply it to yourself, right? So one of the things that I often see with parents is they've started financially planning, but the goal that they're predominantly focused on is their financial security, which is their retirement, right, in the future. And sometimes they'll tell me, well, I have a goal, I have a retirement goal. If need be, I will just dip into that for my child's education. So I don't need to have a separate goal. What are your thoughts on that?
It's not an easy question to answer, because it's a trade-off between two very important life decisions. Mm-hmm. And there's a school of thought that if you have worked hard for your own financial safety, focus on that, be a bit selfish. And if you don't have enough money to fulfill your child's education, then maybe compromise on the nature of college or school. And then the child will find its own destiny and decide. I don't have an easy answer to that. And it's a personal choice again, that you want to compromise your own goals for the sake of your kids. Most parents would do that, because ultimately, I think we all live for our children, and that's our primary objective. And I feel like talking about my driver, who has three kids, and I think all his generation would have lived in poverty and in difficult conditions. But he took the bold decision, or had the vision or the dream to say that I don't want my next generation to, you know, again struggle. Mm-hmm. So come what may, he ended up either saving enough money through his own savings or, you know, my inputs to him, to now send his daughter for aeronautical engineering.
Wow.
And hopefully in the next 12 months she'll become an engineer. And he keeps telling me that whatever small loans you have given me, this is the last year, I will completely repay all of them from just the first salary she earns. Now, I ask him, why do you have the confidence that whatever she earns, she's going to give it to you to repay? But he has that confidence, because he says that I've invested in her to bring her to this level of, achieving that education, which eventually will liberate the next entire generation from living hand to mouth.
Yes.
And I think that revolution should happen in India in the next 10, 20 years. Where less privileged working class aspires a lot more for their next generation and their kids. And if we can partner them, we can guide them, we can help them, we can coach them and support them in taking that decision, either financially or even in terms of how to invest and how to, you know, navigate.
Anecdotally, my own mama, when my cousin was born, I think he started an SIP of that time, probably 5,000 or 6,000 rupees. And he didn't know much about markets. Someone just approached him in the hospital when she was born and said, look, you have to do this, it's very important. And if you do it, you'll see, you know, 15, 20 years down the road what it will yield you. So he had faith, he did a bit of research, he called a few people to his house that were offering this program. He sat with them and said, okay, done. I'll invest every month $100, whatever SIP equivalent that was at the time. And 18 years later, he had enough money to fund her entire undergraduate degree.
So it's very nice to know that 15 years back, because today we hear about mutual funds sahi hai, SIP sahi hai, but 15 years ago, very few people were talking that language. So I must compliment whoever must have told your mama about, you know, this plan, and also to him for having that faith and taking that decision. Because many people don't decide. We procrastinate a lot. We delay our decisions, especially in investing, most decisions are delayed.
What is one, I guess, thing that you would want every Indian to know about investing?
I think the only thing I would want them to know is expenses are much higher. Our inflation rates are much higher than our savings returns, than the returns that we earn on our savings, because our savings are very random. They are not well thought through. They are not scientifically designed. So, like I said, our single-minded objective should be to ensure that our hard-earned money is earning rates of return better than inflation. And that can only happen if you become a good investor. And you can become a good investor only if you take financial planning seriously.
Thank you so much, Kalpenji, for your precious time and for sitting here with us today. I personally loved listening to your story as, of course, a professional, but also as a parent, which I'm sure so many of our viewers can deeply empathize with. I know that Raising a child is definitely not easy in today's day and age, but I also know that if you do it with the right intent, with the right foresight, it's definitely possible. I also think there are a lot of parents that probably are now going to be a lot more comfortable investing in the markets, or at least researching more after having listened to you. So thank you again for your time.
Thanks, Ila, for inviting me firstly, and for also, you know, starting this business model of helping parents connect their education goals with a medium which can help them achieve their goals, which is investing. And I wish all the viewers success in that journey. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you to our audience for listening in today on another episode of Chasing Dreams. As you can see, Kalpinji has been investing for a very, very long time, but he started off just like any of us, which was a simple goal in mind, which is to start and to grow his capital. Tune in for another episode very soon. Thank you.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.